name is Luigi Boschetti, and I'm a professor of remote sensing at the College of Natural Resources of the University of Idaho. And I am the lead developer of the module on the estimation of greenhouse gas emissions from biomass burning. The background for this lecture is section 2.6 on the GOSI Gold source book, the 2006 IPCC guidelines, in particular chapter 2, volume 4, and you will find plenty of additional material on the GOSI Gold Fire Implementation Team portal. In particular, you'll find more on currently available fire mapping projects and data sets. The first section is designed a quick overview of the complex issues related to fire. There are multiple effects when studying fire in ecosystems, and the impacts of fire vary widely depending on the type of fire and on the ecosystem. Fire is a global phenomenon. It's important and a poorly understood component of the Earth system processes. There are multiple loops and feedbacks between fire, hydrological processes, the atmosphere, ecosystems, and the human population. For example, if we look at the hydrosphere, fire does have, through burned watersheds, fire does have an impact on erosion and water quality. If we look at the atmosphere, then the main component is the release of greenhouse gases through burning, as well as the release of aerosol, smoke, and clouds. On the ecosystems, fire has an effect both as a disturbance and as a part of ecosystem management. In particular, there is, in recent year, the awareness of the necessity of moving from total suppression of fire in wildlands to the recognition that fire is an important and natural process. So the emphasis moving from fighting fires to managing fuels. Finally, looking at the human environment, we do have fire as a threat due to uncontrolled fires, in particular the wildland-urban interface. Fire as a risk when looking at air quality and impacts of fire on human health. But also we have fire as a tool that humans can use to manage the ecosystems and the environment. We have different fires with different causes. Natural fires caused by volcanoes and lightning, and human-induced fires, and these are the majority, especially in the past 100 years. Human-induced fires have a variety of causes and uses, deforestation to agricultural fires, land management, pest control, production use of charcoal, fuel wood used for heating and cooking, arson, and even cultural use of fire. Not all fires are the same. We do have wildland fires with a negative impact on the ecosystem, but we also have prescribed fires that are recognized as an essential tool for fire management, reducing fuel loads and reducing the risk of catastrophic fires. Looking at impacts of fire, we can touch quickly on wildlife and habitat biodiversity. It goes beyond the direct mortality of animals. Fires can be good and bad. We do have a potential positive impact of fires in some cases when promoting and maintaining biodiversity, but also fires as a threat to ecosystem, for instance, when wildfires and invasive species are linked, or where changing fire regimes pose a threat on biodiversity and ecosystem conservation. In forests, fires have a gradient of impacts from low severity to high severity fires in the first case, only the understory is affected, while on high severity fires, there is elevated mortality due to combustion of the crown, and there is a near complete loss of the soil organic carbon and of the seed bank, leading to very lengthy recovery from fire. Looking at soils, fire can cause increased water runoff, erosion, loss of soil organic carbon, and they pose a great emphasis on the need for rapid coast fire assessment and treatment. But fire is not just negative. Fire is important in maintaining some ecosystems in equilibrium. In particular, savannas and grasslands would not exist if we did not have fire. There are some experiments showing wall-to-wall comparison of extreme fire suppression and frequent fires. In this case, we are looking at an experiment in the Kruger National Park. On one side, we have yearly fire in an open savanna, and on the other side, we have extreme fire suppression for the same. So with the same soil and the same climate, we have two completely different vegetation covers due to repeated fire. Fires affect a significant portion of the planet, annually over 3.7 million square kilometers, with emissions not only of CO2, but also of other greenhouse gases, particulate and aerosol. Fire affects all biomes, but the majority of emissions are due to fires in savannas, followed by tropical deforestation and degradation, woodlands fires, and agricultural waste and peatlands, as estimated by Guido van der Werf in 2010. Fire is important in the Red Plus process at various levels, and incorporating the use of fire monitoring from satellite can be crucial at different stages. We have the necessity of early warning systems to protect forest areas at risk, so in a pre-fire stage to avoid areas where there are red plus actions in place to prevent these areas to be affected by fires. During a fire in forest, satellite data can be used as a support for in-situ actions and firefighting. In post-fire, satellite data can be used to estimate the perimeter of the area affected by the fire, and in turn to estimate the amount of greenhouse gases that have been released. In this module, we will mostly look at this last aspect. It's important to keep in mind that fire has all of these multiple roles, not just a disturbance, but also a change of ecological change, a management tool, and the process associated with land cover conversion. At the moment, the source book deals only with emissions from above ground biomass. More research is underway for monitoring and calculating emissions from below ground biomass using standard off-the-shelf satellite products and simple repeatable approaches. A variety of red plus potential activities are covered by fire. Have a relevant component due to fire. So fire monitoring can be incorporated in a variety of Red Plus projects. So we have two main categories of activities where calculating fire emissions is relevant. we can map and monitor fires as a disturbance for carbon inventories when fire leads to forest loss and forest degradation, but also we can account for emissions in fire-prone ecosystems where fire should not be suppressed but managed and incorporated in the practices to maintain a healthy ecosystem. The IPCC guidelines describe a generic methodology for calculating emissions from fire using the so-called bottom-up approach. The approach is based on work done in the early 80s by Cedar and Crutzen and is very suitable for being implemented in a GIS environment and for the use of readily available remotely sensed data sets. There are alternative approaches, for instance, directly looking at the atmospheric composition or looking at the energy released by the fires. But these approaches are still experimental and are not readily implementable with off-the-shelf data sets. That is the focus of the source book. In the bottom-up approach, the emissions for each gas are calculated as a product of the area burnt multiplied by the fuel load before the fire multiplied by a combustion factor, the fraction of biomass that is combusted due to the fire, multiplied once again by the amount of gas released per unit of biomass consumed by the fire. So if we look through the terms, the area multiplied by the fuel load will give us the total amount of biomass that was there before the fire. We multiply that by the combustion factor and we have the total amount of biomass that was combusted. We multiply that by the emission factors and we end up with the amount of each species of gas that was emitted by the fire. We can do that in forests, but we can also do that in savanna and in other fire-prone ecosystems. This is because, as per the Marrakesh Accords, natural ecosystems with over 33% recover are considered forest, but ecosystems with a recover between 10 and 30% can be included at the discretion of the country. And this includes the majority of fire-prone ecosystems. In forest, when fire is a disturbance and leads to forest loss and forest degradation, the IPCC guidelines prescribe that both CO2 emissions and all other greenhouse gases are computed. In savannas and grasslands, however, fire is assumed to be a natural component of the ecosystem, and the assumption is that within the year, all the vegetation that was lost due to fire will regrow. As a consequence, the CO2 emissions are balanced by carbon absorption within the year, with a net zero effect. However, fire will have released non-CO2 gases that otherwise would not have been released, and these gases must be accounted for. For a bottom-up emission estimation as a consequence, going through the terms of the equation, we need spatially and temporally distributed burnt area maps that are globally available, although with some limitations, and we will be talking about that. Biomass maps, once again, available, but with caveats. Those can be integrated by models and by ground surveys. We do have combustion completeness data, although they are quite uncertain, and we do have emission factors, once again with some caveats. In particular, while there are published emission factors, the temporal variation of these emission factors is not well characterized yet. Existing global products off the shelf are sufficient for a tier 1 far emission calculation. With some extra work, they can be brought to a tier 2 by associating uncertainty when possible. And tier 3 assessments definitely are possible, but they cannot rely on the available global products that are not designed for this use. When we talk about fire remote sensing, we do have two main families of products: active fire products and burnt area products. This is a fundamental distinction, and it's very important to understand what products we are dealing with. Not only they portray different phenomena, but they are generated in a completely different manner. Active fire products include the detection of fires that are actively burning at the overpass time of the satellite. For example, using MODIS data, we do have two sensors, two identical MODIS sensors on two platforms, Terra and Aqua. Combined, we do have up to 4 observations a day, 2 during the day and 2 at night, 10:30 a.m., 1:30 p.m., 10:30 p.m., 1:30 a.m. local time. The MODIS active fire product, called MOD 14, will include detection of fires that are actively burning at those 4 times of the day when the satellite passes. From a remote sensing science perspective, the detection is based mostly on middle infrared and thermal infrared data, detecting the anomalous release of energy due to the combustion. Burnt area products instead include the information on what areas have been affected by fire within a certain time interval. We do have a variety of these products, from MODIS on generated by NASA, and a variety of products generated by the European Space Agency and the European Commission in the context, for instance, of the Climate Change Initiative, the CCI. In this case, the detection is not based on the energy released by the fire, but is based on the effect of fire on the vegetation. So looking at the presence of charcoal and ash, the removal of photosynthetically active material, and the changes in vegetation structure. In this case, the detection is based on shortwave infrared optical data, visible and shortwave and middle infrared, looking at the changes in spectral signature. Ideally, we should be able to accumulate over time active fire detections and have exactly the same perimeter that we see in a burnt area product. In reality, we rarely have that because of two phenomena that have a sort of competing effect. On the one hand, satellites can image an area only at discrete intervals. We do have only a limited set of overpasses, going from daily to hourly and sub-hourly in the case of geostationary satellites. If we don't have a satellite passing at the precise moment when the fire is affecting an area, we cannot have an active fire detection. Also, we need to take into account the fact that clouds and smoke can preclude the view and therefore
preclude detection. On top of that, we need to take into account the fact that the spatial resolution thermal sensors is generally pretty low, in the order of the kilometer, but very small fires can still trigger a detection. So the fact that a 1 kilometer pixel is flagged as a pixel containing an active fire does not mean that we necessarily have a square kilometer, 100 hectares, of burnt area. As a matter of fact, in forest, it has been demonstrated that it is enough to have 100 square meters of fire front to flag the entire pixel as burning. So depending on the vegetation and fire characteristics, we can have completely different outcomes. In savannas and grasslands, active fire products severely underestimate the area affected by the fire, due to the fact that the fire front is moving much faster than the sampling interval of the satellite. But in fragmented savannas, we also have plenty of small fires that can be detected as an active fire, but they are too small to result in a burnt area detection. In forest ecosystems, however, fire fronts move slowly and are fully captured by the active fire product. So there is only the overestimation effect due to the fact that small fires still trigger a detection in a 1 square kilometer pixel. Finally, land clearing fires are picked up as actively burning fires, but they often do not result in any burnt area detection, because in this case we have a removal of the valuable timber, piling of the slash in piles, and then the burning, not as a wildfire, but as a managed fire, as a pile of fuel. Therefore, we do not have a large spot of charcoal on the ground, and we do not detect it as a burnt area. We can still detect the clearing from remote sensing data as a transition from forest to non-forest, though. Looking at images, in this first example, we have a very large burnt area in Australia. The one on the right-hand side was over 2,600 square kilometers, and it burned for about 3 months. We see the burnt areas are very large and very compact shapes. However, the corresponding active fire detections are very fragmented, and they capture only part of the areas. This is the effect of the sampling interval of the satellite. These are modest data, so 4 times a day were not sufficient to capture entirely the movement of the fire front. In the second example, we move to Africa and the Southern Hemisphere, where we have a mix of large and small burnt areas, and the corresponding active fires, we see a combination of the two effects. We do have a number of small fires that were not captured as active fires, especially in the northern part of the area. And we do have the larger burnt areas that are not fully captured as active fires. That's in the southern part of the image. We move to boreal forest in Siberia. We have burnt areas and active fires covering roughly the same area, but we do have some small fires that did not result in a large burnt area and were not detected as burnt areas. Finally, moving to Amazonia, to an area of active deforestation, we see that some of the recently deforested patches are detected as burnt areas, but there's many more active fires. fires. These additional active fires are areas where the forest was cleared, valuable timber was removed, and the slash was burnt, not on the on the ground, but without leaving a large area that we can detect due to the deposition of charcoal. So this is the final case where we do have many more active fire detection than burnt area detections. This pattern that we've seen in a few representative cases is also confirmed when the analysis is done systematically. If we take 1 year of burnt area product data and the corresponding 1 year of active fire product data, and we compare the proportion of area in cause resolution cells, we stratify that by land cover, and we see that when the tree cover is very small, beyond 10%, we tend to have a much larger area identified as burn in the burnt area product than in active fire product. As the tree cover goes up, the slope of this regression line will increase. And by the time we get to a closed forest, we see that we have a similar proportion of burnt areas and active fires. Finally, when looking just at a few areas of a very close forest that do burn, we have more active fire detections than burnt area detections. This distinction is very important because not all products are suitable for the area computation that is required for the bottom-up estimation of emissions. We do have, at the moment, a wide variety of satellites that are collecting Earth observation data. But fire, being a non-permanent land cover change, poses some strict requirements both on the type of data we collect, both on the spectral content of the data, and on the temporal frequency. At the moment, there are hyperspatial data, 1 to 10 meter, or even submetric, that are available only very sporadically. We do have moderate resolution data, 10-30 meter data, and that's the Sentinel-2 and Landsat class data, that is available with a frequency that goes from weekly to monthly. And we do have coarse resolution data, so well over 100 meter spatial resolution, that are available daily. And those are the data sets that are currently used for the systematic generation of fire products. So we don't have really data with the accuracy we need, with the frequency we need. At the moment, there's several systematic fire products, but not with a resolution close to what 1 hectare that would be ideal. And not all of these products are well validated either. There are some cases of high resolution mapping systems with a desirable one hectare or below resolution, but at the moment those are only experimental, available in some countries or in the prototype phase. There are several projects that are aiming at developing Landsat and Sentinel-2 systematic products, but those are not available at this time. They might be available in a few years' time. This is a list of some available products. For a regularly updated list of global and regional products, I invite you to look on the GovSea Fire Team portal. We do have a variety of products. On active fires, for instance, there's active fire products. that from MODIS, VIRS, geostationary satellites, and we do have a good amount of historical data from, for instance, from ATSR. Bird-terrier products are currently systematically generated from MODIS, and those are the products supported by NASA, from ProbeV and Spot Vegetation, and those are the products supported by the European Commission as part of the Copernicus Global Land Services, and from a variety of sensors as part of the 5CCI initiative supported by the European Space Agency. There are also some systematic emission products, in particular the Global Emission Database, GFED, and the MAC2 Global Fire Analysis and Estimates of Emission from Fires project, also part of GMES and Copernicus. It is standard procedure to use high resolution and moderate resolution data in limited cases for generating reference data used in the validation of cause resolution data. It's very accurate, but time consuming. At the moment, it does require a phenomenal amount of manual work for the digitization. There are experimental projects for the systematic generation of 30 meter scale, but there is no global coverage yet. And this is a big limitation, and in the next years, I would expect that we will be able to do all of these calculations using data at 1 hectare or better. Going back to the way of implementing the bottom-up approach. Once again, emissions are estimated as a product of the area burnt, the fuel load, the combustion factor, and the emission factors. This approach is just linear, it's just a combination of layers, and is naturally suitable to be implemented in a GIS environment using raster data. So if we have rasters, we can just compute the amount of emissions for each pixel, for each cell. If I is a generic cell, we can rewrite the bottom-up equation where for each burnt area pixel, we multiply the area, the footprint of the pixel, by the biomass load, the combustion factor, and emission factor on this particular location. Now let's go to the IPCC recommendations. To do a Tier 1 assessment, all what we need is burnt area, and we can use one of the systematic products, for instance, the MODIS product, the Copernicus product, or the 5CCI product, and tables from the IPCC guidelines that are published and stratified by land cover class, providing reference values of biomass, combustion completeness, and emission factors. I invite you to look at the examples that accompany the source book for examples of calculations and step-by-step calculations of emissions at Tier 1 using existing products. When moving from Tier 1 to Tier 2 and Tier 3, it's important and necessary to be aware of the sources of error that we include doing a bottom-up approach. All of the terms of the equation are affected by errors, not in the same way. areas used to be one of the biggest sources of error when the bottom-up approach was introduced in the 80s, but in particular in the last 20 years, an enormous effort has been supported by the space agencies and by governmental organizations in improving burnt area mapping algorithms and products. As a result, globally, the uncertainties have been greatly reduced. However, these are global products. So at the local scale, we can still have errors that can be in the order of 50%, overestimation or underestimation. Biomass loads and combustion factors are very poorly characterized in the literature. So emission factor tables and combustion factor tables as the ones that are in the IPCC guidelines do have large uncertainties, and what is worse, these uncertainties are not well documented. So in particular, when moving to a tier 3 assessment, it is important to have models and measurements for the area of interest. Finally, I would like to point out a few other potential uses of fire data in support of REDD+. We just said that when moving from a tier 1 to a tier 2 or tier 3 approach, it might be necessary to have better quality data sets, and the global data sets will not be adequate. However, the global products can still be used to identify where to acquire the high resolution imagery and where to refine the map. In this slide, we see an example where the global MODIS burnt area and active fire products are used to identify where and when there are fires in a forest in Australia. The red square is the WRS pass row of Landsat, so the global products are used to pinpoint the location of potential fires, and then the Landsat image is acquired and manually digitized or processed with a higher process to generate a burnt area map at higher resolution and with higher accuracy. A second potential use is to look at trends. We do have a nice long time series of Earth observation data of the Landsat class, a 30 meter resolution, that can be used not just for mapping fires, but also to understand what happens after a fire. To see, for instance, if a fire results in a conversion from forest to non-forest land. In this case, we are looking at a big fire in the Rocky Mountains at the border between the United States and Canada. The fire happened in 2001, and in the Landsat image we see the footprint of the fire. Now, if we look at Landsat images in the years following the fire, we can understand if this fire was followed by conversion to a non-forest land cover and land use or not. And when we look at the 2002 and 2003 data, it's clear that in this case the forest is regenerated and there is no land use conversion. Also, the products themselves now constitute a fairly long record. And looking at the time span of satellite observations, it is now an environmental record of significant length. We do have, not for the whole globe, but at least in some locations, Landsat data from the early 70s And everywhere we have high quality daily data since the 2000s. So these data sets can be used to establish the fundamental question of what is the baseline of our activity. Once the products are calibrated and validated, we can use them, we can use the available data sets to understand if there are trends in our activity and in which direction. We can establish climatology fields. For instance, in this case, we have fire season parameters that were derived from the first years of MODIS Active Fire product. Another example, some climatology from the MODIS Burn Tearing product, the median day of burning for the whole of Australia from the first 8 years of MODIS Burn Tearing data, and the complementary information, that is how many times a pixel was seen as burnt. As a follow-up to this module, I recommend going to module 2.7 to continue the estimation of uncertainty, module 2.8 to learn more about evolving technologies for monitoring forest area changes, stocks and emissions, and modules in section 3 to proceed with red assessment and reporting. Thank you for listening, and have a good continuation of this red course.